find a way to cross and you're gonna get there. And I'm on fire today. Ain't no water here to calm or even put me off. I find a better way. Am I crazy or the wind is gonna blow me down?
Welcome to week 7 of the Bill Nees's Coach Show. I'm your host, Chip Hare. With us is Coach Bill Nees, and a lot to say. The battered helmet comes back to Piqua. Indians win in an electric game and the first league game of the division by a score of 14-12. Big win in a lot of ways.
I think it was. I think big for our seniors. I knew it was big for our seniors after the game was over with. They walked into the team room while all the coaches were in the team room, and they put the helmet back where it normally belongs. And I didn't really think that I knew they wanted to win the game, but I didn't really think they were going to, be into it that much in order to put it back where it was, make a formal presentation, et cetera, et cetera. So I think it was big for them. I think it was also big for our juniors and sophomores because they see that, and I think they now realize how important it is that, we got jacked up because it wasn't here and we had to go get it and bring it home. But I think it's going to be just as important now to, every year now to keep it where it belongs, in our minds where it belongs, and to make sure that thing stays safe and secure here at Alexander Perk Field.
Every game is big. We always talk about that, Coach, one week at a time. This game, through the years, and particularly this year, it was different. Walking in the through warm-ups, the pregame, and then certainly right before kickoff, you could tell there was a little different electricity in the air. This one was special in a lot of ways.
Well, definitely it was. I think and Sidney has done their part in making it special. I know one time they had a coach that said, they asked him about the rivalry, and Sidney's coach said, well, it's not a rivalry when the same team keeps winning all the time. And I think Sidney has now got into position with their culture and with some of the things they're doing in their weight room and some of the competitive players and talent they're developing. And I think that's a big thing, that this thing has now risen up. And a rivalry is only great when both teams have a chance to win, both teams feel like they can right. win, and they come in with a little bit of swagger and a very proud attitude.
Well, the swagger was certainly on both ends or both sides of the ball. We could talk about a lot of plays. There were a lot of challenges that we had to overcome, amongst self-inflicted on ourselves, some by calls or whatnot. You have to handle those. But the one you look at, it might come down the play of the game is a blocked punt. Brennan Toops taking it back and putting it in the position to score early on in the first second quarter.
We had flipped the defense and he lined up over the center. Center snapped the ball and didn't get a great block on him. And Brennan just came rolling in there, put a hand up and went from there. It's just a play where if Brennan had not been in that position, if he had lined up in his normal spot, that guy would have probably paid a little bit more attention to him and would have been able to get a better block on him.
So the Indians, extra points were another key to the game. The Indians are 2-for-2 on those. Jackets weren't able to convert at the end of the game. That really made a big difference.
Oh, it did. And interesting that 2 years in a row now, it's come down to a two-point play. And, 2 years in a row, it went in favor of the defense in both of those occasions. Interesting. And then I think the last time Sidney won the game, it came down to a field goal at the end of the game. So the kicking game has become important, and again, that what I was saying before, when the kicking game is that important, that means that there's two really good teams, and it's all the little things. It's just those little things that you have to make sure you get done. I thought we did a great job of punting the ball, at the end. I still can't believe we didn't run the clock out. All right, but that would be another story, and it would take too long for us to tell right now. But the fact that we were able to knock the ball down to the 1 yard line,
it's a great punt,
and have them come out of there with that's probably as big a nightmare for a coach as possible, to come 99 yards and no timeouts. That was a tough situation, and I thought our defense held up, obviously held up well.
A lot of big plays, as you're talking about, like that punt there at the end, and then the defense coming mm-hmm. at different spots. We could name a lot of different guys that made big plays at different points, but what was interesting, what was fun to watch, is it truly was a team win, both offensively and defensively. People did their jobs. Yeah, we got some penalties that maybe we probably got a few more than we wanted, but yet we overcame that.
We did, and that's I told the offensive line and the offense in general tonight. I said the the interesting thing about the situation is we're driving, and then we do something to ourselves, and then we got to start all over again. We make up for it. We overcome it. We drive, do something again. And I said, we continually overcome this stuff, but at some point, against a very good football team who is not turning the ball over, because, you know, Sidney made a couple mistakes themselves, but if we play somebody that's playing a flawless game, yeah, that's going to hurt us.
The philosophy of and the tough one is you want to enjoy it, but after the game, I heard you on the field. Okay, hey, congratulations on the battered helmet on a Greenville.
Yeah, because we're not going to give Greenville, you know, a chance to say, hey, they're still thinking about Sidney. You know, we're going to come in here and we're going to do this. And now Greenville's got our full attention now. Sidney had our full attention last week, and everybody gets our full attention. And we don't skirt on anybody. And so Greenville's going to get our full attention. It was a great win. You know, like I told the seniors, most of the seniors have been our speed camp guys since they've been in fifth and sixth grade. And I said, you know, we were kind of reminiscing about it. I said, man, I think the last time I was at the stadium maybe was when they were in eighth grade. And they were undefeated at the time, and they were going to win. Come over and they played. They locked up against Sidney. It was supposed to be the big eighth grade game of the year, and Sidney just smoked them. And I think those guys, kind of remembered that a little bit, and I think they were, you know, pretty happy. You know, the amount of pictures that they were taking and the amount of, caressing of that battered helmet that they had after the game was over with.
Well, on to Greenville we are. It is homecoming week as well. There's a lot of things. If people see Greenville, they see them on the schedule. This is not the same team that we went over to last year and just rolled over. This is a team that's coming in 3-3, won a close game a couple weeks ago in an overtime. This team is better. They're improved, and we know this is a big – for Greenville, pick was a big game for them, and we know they're going to be coming into Alexander Stadium ready to go.
Yeah, Coach Schaefer is another one of the coaches in the GWOC that I have the utmost respect for. Adam down in Sidney, I think those guys just do a heck of a job with their schemes and with a lot of other things that people that are not in the coaching world don't realize. And I think Schaefer is a good example of that. Those guys come in there, and they will come in Friday night, and they'll stretch us every possible way imaginable, whether or not they're going to stretch us horizontally, vertically, and I'm talking about at the defensive end. And in the meantime, they'll put together some packages. Usually they run some packages against us on defense, so we're going to have to catch some blitzes. We're going to have to figure out, probably see a blitz we hadn't seen all year before.
Yeah.
And it both ends. You know, we're ready to go. He does his homework. He does his preparation. And about every 2, 3, 4 years, Greenville gets on a run. They get on a streak. They got some, you know, pretty good guys, and they're moving in. So they're coming in on, like you said, with a 3-3 record, and they can move the football. They're averaging about 31 points a game right now.
Yeah, their quarterback and their back have proven to be statistically doing some good things. And I know we've said before, when you come into this facility, people get jacked up to play us, and Greenville is going to be no different, particularly with a league game.
No, the quarterback's outstanding. They've got the GWOC leading rusher. The guy, the Eldridge kid almost has 1,000 yards, in 5 games. So
it's pretty impressive.
Yeah, and he's a hard runner. You watch him in film, and this guy's a slasher. You know, typical Greenville, they always have running backs that run hard. You know, there's certain, people say Pickwell has certain characteristics, every year they have this. Well, Greenville's always got a guy that can slash, and he's that guy this year.
For Pickwell, what are some of the keys to the victory on Friday night that we've got to do to make sure that we take care of business?
Well, we can't have the number one thing on my mind, and it will be on my mind until this game's over with, is we can't have our offense standing on the sideline watching our defense try to get the ball back from that Greenville offense. Okay, that's the number one thing. And if we can get that done, then we're going to be all right. So that encompasses everything from big plays to first downs to third down conversions to every other statistic you might want to think of. But it's all going to boil down to whether or not our offense is on the field or our offense is sitting there watching us try to get off the field on defense.
Defensively, for us, you said it, we played pretty well Friday night. Mm-hmm. We put a lot of pressure on our defense. We've got to find ways to stop doing that to our defense, give them some opportunities to get them some rest.
Right, and we've got to continue to convert. We got to play penalty free. I think it's almost, you get to the point where We put some new things in, and we got to make sure we executed that. You know, we want to continue to develop our offense and continue to develop some weapons on offense. And in order to do that, you've got to be able to put stuff in, and then you've got to be able to execute it during the game, whether or not it be motion, whether or not it be changing up your cadence, all those types of things. You don't want to change up your cadence or use motion, and then you end up and draw yourself offsides. Okay, so those are things we got to continue to battle.
Little details, but details that are important for us to win. Coach, I feel like we talk about this every year, but it really does come into play. Talk about week 6 and week 7. Those 2 weeks, week 7 and 8. Mm-hmm. You're now you're past halfway of the season. That grind starts to come through. Not just physically, but mentally and emotionally. Yeah. I know you talk about that with your kids. Here we are, week 7. It's a homecoming game for us. There's potential distractions, but the body gets tired, the mind gets tired. Going through that grind, talk a little bit about that.
Well, the thing that we have to do is we've got to make sure that we're, at times backing off of practice a little bit, not just, beating it down, but on the other hand, you come out of a Friday and you've made a ton of mistakes, then you've got to sit out and we put a little bit extra time in tonight, but I think then tomorrow and maybe Wednesday we'll put a little less time in. But you don't want to give that illusion that you're putting less time in, meaning that something is less important, and that type.
And every team's different. I mean, last year you might have done, or 2 years ago is different. What you do with this team, you got to read your team.
Yeah. That's another thing, we use the weight room well. I think the weight room is important for us because we get in there and make sure those guys are getting their reps, they're getting everything in there. And in season, if you ask any coach in the world what is the hardest thing to deal with, it would have to be in-season weight training. Because you train 9 months out of the year, you do all this stuff, your kids are in the best shape of their life, and then you have to make sure that they're maintaining. It's really hard to have your starters getting stronger. I know we can do it with our JVs, but you got to make sure those guys are in there rep and staying healthy. If they got some bumps and bruises, everybody's first tendency is, well, I don't want to lift. Well, we got to put some lighter weight on, get that range of motion, and get everything going. So I think with the weight room, that kind of stuff helps. And so we'll continue to monitor. We take good progress with it, and I make sure that we check and see whether or not, things are getting stale.
Weight room has been, not just this year, but has been the staple of our success for the football program. And we know that that's obviously going to be a big part of us continuing to get mm-hmm. better and just to stay loose. And it's for our kids, I think they really, there's a psychological piece that, hey, we're in the weight room, I'm getting stronger. And I think that transcends to the field.
It does. We we're blessed that our kids buy into the weight room. The other thing is we're not a weightlifting team. We understand that we're athletes that lift weights to get better, but we need to lift those weights. We can't just go out and compete without that weight room. So they come hand in hand together, and I think that's what's great about the situation we have here.
Moving into our seniors tonight, our two senior features that we'll be talking to is Jordan and Matt. Talk a little bit about those two seniors in particular and how they have been a part of this program, especially this year.
Well, Jordan has been an excellent player for us in terms of his commitment to our program, in terms of his attitude, in terms of his chemistry, everything. And, unfortunately, he suffered a knee injury and was out most of his freshman and a little bit of his sophomore year. Wore the brace. It took a while for him to get back with it. And once he got up the weight room, it was a little hard for him to get back into the leg routine and everything. But he's got back into it. His senior year came up this year, and he's able to play on a couple special teams for us. He contributes at practice any way he can. He's at every practice. He's a kid that has not given me one ounce of anything but cooperation, and I'm here for the team. He's an ideal player. And then Matt, didn't play last year, has been in our program, and came back this summer and said, hey, coach, give me a chance. I want to get back into it. I said, okay, and here's the steps involved. And he came in the whole summer, did everything he had to do, and Matt now is pretty much the same thing as what I would say about Jordan. Anything you can do for the team, Matt will do it. If you need a quarterback to give patterns to the JVs, if you need somebody to spot the ball, if you need this, he's always there. He's always upbeat. He's always positive. George's kind of a quiet guy, whereas Matt's, he's vocal, and it's always in a positive way. And so we really enjoy you know, having Matt on, and I appreciate the fact that he, you know, has put our team number one.
Both of those guys, I think, would say, being around them, they're appreciative of being a part of the program because they feel like they get as much being a part of it from others as they get to themselves. So
yeah, they do. They're, you know, they're great contributors, and everybody recognizes that. And you're two of the most popular guys on the team.
Coach, we certainly wish you luck as we roll into Friday here. A big game, another league game, and it's taking one at a time.
Definitely.
Guys, we will be back for the second half of the Bill Nees's Coaches Show. Remember, it is Friday night here at Alexander Stadium, kickoff at 7 o'clock. We'll be back for part two with Jordan and Matt. Welcome to part two of the Bill Nees's Coaches Show. We are now at our senior feature portion of the show, and I want to have our two seniors introduce themselves and the positions that they play.
Jordan Phillippe, I'm linebacker.
I'm Matt Lynn, defensive end.
Guys, this is obviously we're a little over the halfway of the season. We got to talk real quick. Big win on Friday night. What was that like to be a part of that one?
It was very exciting, you know. I was glad to be there and everything.
Yeah, Matt, how about you going over to Sidney and get one at what is the first league game of the division with that kind of electricity? Pretty neat.
Yeah, it was really fun. I'm glad we got the dub.
Yeah, here we are now. We're moving forward to Greenville. But for you guys have been part of the program in different ways. You know, Jordan, for you, you tear your ACL, your eighth grade year. That's a big blow. But you keep coming back and you just keep getting stronger. Tell us a little bit about that injury and then how it's really kind of helped you propel yourself to where you are today.
It was very tough getting back, you know. It took a very long time to get back and everything. And you know, I just had to keep chugging along, you know, keep telling myself, you know, I still want to play sports, you know, I still want to play football and everything. And, yeah, it was a very difficult time at the time.
Weight room probably helps you a great deal, too.
Yeah, definitely.
What part of this year is, you know, you're part of special teams and you've been able to get in there and play in some important plays of the game. What's that like to know that you're underneath the lights and you've gone through all those struggles? And here you are being a part of something that's pretty special.
It's a very exciting, you know, and I'm glad to be here on the team. And it's just a really exciting thing, you know.
Well, Matt, talk a little bit about your situation. Here you are, you come in your senior year, really have put yourself in a situation where you are a guy that they count on. And you also get a chance to see some things on Saturday morning. From your perspective, what's it like to be a part of the Pickle football program?
It's really fun. Everybody here treats you like family no matter what. You know, I quit and then I came back and everybody just still accepted me, and I still had to work as hard as everybody else did. And they're just like a family.
I think that says a lot about you. You know, you left the program last year and then you come back and you go through all the off-season stuff. And we've talked about this on the show a lot, about the off-season stuff. That's not easy to do. And you keep hanging in there. You know, I've been on the sideline. You and I talked about this. You cheer as loud as anyone on that sideline. And when you get your shot, I know those guys are encouraging you.
Yeah, I just know they're going to be there for me, so I got to be there for them when they needed it most.
That's good stuff. As we talk a little bit about, both of you guys are Upper Valley career students, right?
Yeah.
So let's talk a little bit about Upper Valley career. Last week, we had Trent Foster and we had Mr. Strayer on here and Jacob, and then they talked about what Upper Valley meant to them. How's that what program are you guys in over there, and how's that program been for you?
I'm in electrical applications and I've learned a lot of things from it, and yeah, I'm hoping to have a field in that.
Good fit for you over there?
Yeah, very.
So long term afterwards, what's your thoughts when you get out of Upper Valley? Where do you want to be?
I'm hoping to be in college and pursue computer engineering.
You know what schools are we looking at this point?
First, I'll probably go to Edison and then probably continue at Wright State.
Great opportunity to go through Edison and get that 2+2 program where you get your 2 years and then transfer on to a 4-year. That's great. Matt, how about yourself? What program are you in over at Upper Valley?
I'm in manufacturing technology. So it's like you work with different machines and everything. That way you're prepped and ready for a factory job out of high school. And something I want to do later on down the line out of school is attend the University of Toledo and then for 2-4 years and then maybe transfer to a different school out of state.
So Upper Valley's been a good situation for you, too. Yeah, I think we see a lot of young people, young ladies and young men have gone over to Upper Valley. It's been a good partnership, and I'm glad to hear that you guys have taken advantage of it. Hey, last thing before we get into, before we close it up, talk to me a little bit about this year. You know, we've got now, we're 4 weeks left. We're into the what a lot of people would call that last month, whereas the fun month. What's it like for you now? What are some of the things that you're looking forward to seeing and being a part of here the next 4 weeks?
I'm looking forward to the last few weeks of practice, you know, and enjoying the last days of practice and being a part of the team for the last year.
Well, Jordan, we appreciate your efforts and everything you've given. Matt, how about you? Where do you see things here the next 4 weeks? What are some of the things you're looking forward to?
One of the things I'm really looking forward to, and this team is really looking forward to, is the last game. I think we're going to do really well in the second half of the season. We really got our head in the game. Now we practice really hard in any kind of weather, any kind of condition. We always come out here, the guys sweat, work, do everything we possibly can. And I think we're really ready to rock the second half of the season.
Well, we certainly know that getting a good start off last week with Sidney certainly helps us getting into that portion of it. We know we've got to take 1 week at a time. And we certainly wish you guys the best of luck this year, but also as we graduate and you get into the future years. Guys, thanks a lot. Just a reminder that on Friday night, it is homecoming night. That is, the Indians will be kicking off against the Green Wave. Kickoff is at 7 o'clock here at Alexander Stadium. There will be a replay of that on Monday night at 5:30 with, of course, the pregame show with Dwayne Bachman and Bob Luby. You can catch that here on the Indian Nation Station. For Jordan and Matt, I'm your host, Chip Hare. We will see you next week on the Bill Nees's Coaches Show. Have a good night, everybody.